Hi everyone, it's Professor Primpton. In this video we're going to talk about how to maximize revenue and profit functions that come up in applied optimization problems. So in this video we're going to talk about how to solve applied problems that involve optimization for revenue, profit, or cost functions. So let's pick up where we left off. We're going to start solving applied optimization problems that involve revenue and profit functions. So maximizing revenue and profit. Whenever we're trying to maximize the revenue, businesses are also faced with the constraint of consumer demand. So while the business would love to see lots of products sold at a very high price, typically demand decreases as the price of goods increase. In very simple cases, we can actually construct the demand equation and then actually find out what is the maximum revenue possible. So what this is saying is that if you increase prices indefinitely, eventually the demand will go down, and so will your revenue and your profits. So example three, maximizing revenue. A concert promoter has found that she sells tickets for $50 each, then she can sell 1,200 tickets. However, if she raises the price by $5 per ticket, then 50 less people will attend the concert. What price should she sell the concert tickets to maximize her revenue? So let's start this optimization problem by finding out what is the function that we're trying to maximize or minimize. We're trying to find out how many concert tickets should be sold so that the person is maximizing the revenue. So our revenue function is what's being maximized. So that's the objective function. Remember how the revenue function is defined. The revenue is P times Q. P is the price, and that'll be price per concert, and Q represents the quantity. So in this case, it'll be quantity of tickets sold. So revenue is always price times quantity. There's information in the problem that relates the price of a ticket for how many tickets are actually sold. So if the tickets are $50 each, it's 1,200 tickets sold. And so if you increase the price by $5, 50 less people will attend. So let's make a table of values. You have the price P. If we have a price is $50 per ticket, 1,200 people will attend. That's the quantity Q. If you increase the price to $55, then 50 less people will attend. That's 1,150 people will attend. And it continues this way. If you increase the price again to $60, another 50 less people will attend the concert, so now you're down to 1,100 people. And again, if you increase the price to $65, then another 50 less people will attend, so now you're down to 1,050 people will attend the concert. Notice in the problem that every time that you increase the price by $5, 50 less people will attend. That's a constant rate of change. So the demand is a linear function. So let's find out the slope, or the average rate of change, for the table of values. The average rate of change, or the slope, let's pick 2 points from the table of values. I'm going to use the first 2 points, or the first two set of values from the table. We have 1,150 tickets sold, subtract 1,200 tickets sold, divided by $55, subtract $50. That gives you negative 50 divided by 5, or, which gives you negative 10. So the average rate of change, or the slope, is negative 10 for the demand equation. So now that we know what the slope is, let's find out the demand equation. So we can use point slope form to find out the equation of the demand. When we have the slope is negative 10, and we can use 1 point from the table of values. I'm going to use the first point, which was 50, 1,200. So if you have point slope form, that's y minus y1 equals slope times the parentheses x minus x1. That would be y is the q, because we're talking about the demand. So q subtract y1 is the ticket sold, so 1,200 equals the slope, or the average rate of change is negative 10, times in parentheses x minus x1. Well, x was representing the price, so p subtract x1, which is 50. So you have q subtract 1,200, and then you have on the other side of the equation, negative 10 can be distributed through the parentheses to get negative 10p, and then plus 500, and now solve for q. So add 1,200 to both sides of the equation, and you'll get q equals negative 10 plus 1,700. So this is the price demand equation. So now we have a way to find out what is the revenue function in terms of only one variable. Remember, revenue is price times quantity, or p times q. We know what q is now. So we can have revenue function is r equals p times q. Replace the q with what we just found out. So p times negative 10p plus 1,700. And now notice that r is in terms of only one variable, only in terms of p. So now you can simplify. So distribute the p through the parentheses to get negative 10p squared plus 1,700p. And so r is equal to negative 10p squared plus 1,700p. So now we can use calculus methods to help us find out what is the absolute maximum or the absolute minimum for the revenue function. So let's take the derivative. If you take the derivative of r, you'll get r prime. And then the derivative of the right side of the equation, use the constant multiple rule, the power rule, and the sum rule to find out that the derivative of negative 10p squared is negative 20p. The derivative of 1,700p is just 1,700. And so this is just a polynomial. So we can find out where is the derivative of 0 or where is the derivative of undefined. Well, r prime is undefined, never occurs because we don't have the variable p in the denominator for the derivative, but the derivative could be 0. So r prime equals 0 gives you an equation to solve. You have negative 20p plus 1,700 equals 0. And if you solve for p, you'll come up with p equals 85. So since we only have one critical number, we can use the second derivative test for local extrema to find out, at the critical number, is the revenue function a concave up or is it concave down? So the second derivative test for local extrema says, take the first derivative, which was r prime equals negative 20p plus 1,700, and now take the second derivative. So the derivative of r prime is r double prime, and the derivative of the right side of the equation would give you negative 20 plus 0, or just negative 20. So the revenue function is always negative 20, or it's always a negative number. So that means the revenue function is concave down for all values of p. And so if the revenue function is concave down, that means the revenue function will have an absolute maximum. So the absolute maximum for the revenue function will occur when the price is $85. So let's find out what is the revenue when the price is $85. So if you take $85, which is p, and plug it into the revenue function, you can find out how much revenue was generated. R of 85 would be negative 10 times 85 squared plus 1,700 times 85. That's $72,250. So when tickets are $85 each, the person will have a revenue of $72,250. And we can also find out what Q is. Q, we found out earlier, was negative 10 times P plus 1,700. If you replace P with 85, Q would be negative 10 times 85 plus 1,700. That is 85. So if the concert promoter sells 85 tickets at $85 each, they will have a maximum revenue of $72,250. You may have heard in the business or economics class that profit is maximized when the marginal cost and the marginal revenue are equal. We're going to see why this is true, to maximize profit. Suppose that we want to maximize profit for a business. We now know the steps that's needed to solve an optimization problem involving the profit function. Begin by determining the profit function, calculate the derivative, and then find all the critical numbers for the profit function's derivative, and then use the first or the second derivative test for local extrema to find out, does that critical number give you an absolute maximum for the profit function? However, we can also talk about what this means. You can maximize profit when marginal cost and marginal revenue are equal. So we know that the profit function is revenue subtract cost. So P of X is R of X subtract C of X. If you take the derivative on both sides of the equation, you get an equation involving derivatives. You have P prime of X on the left side of the equation equals the derivative of revenue, that's R prime of X, subtract the derivative of cost would be C prime of X. In other words, this is marginal profit is equal to marginal revenue subtract marginal cost. We know that we have critical numbers whenever the marginal profit is equal to 0. So let's take this equation and set it equal to 0. So P prime of X is equal to R prime of X subtract C prime of X, and all equals 0. If you take the right side of the equation and solve for R prime of X or C prime of X, you notice that P prime of X is equal to 0 when R prime of X and C prime of X, or marginal revenue and marginal cost, are equal to each other. So maximizing profit. To maximize profit, capital P of X, find the values where the marginal revenue function of X is equal to the marginal cost function of X. In other words, where the marginal revenue and the marginal cost are the same. In all cases that we'll see in this course, the profit function will be a polynomial function, and we will not need to worry about critical numbers where the marginal profit function is undefined. It's only where p prime of x is equal to 0. However, keep in mind that not all critical numbers will either be a local maximum or a local minimum. There are values where the marginal revenue equals marginal cost, but they're not actually a local max or a local min. So let's take a look at example 4, maximizing profit. A company sells Q ribbon winders per year at p dollars each. The demand equation for ribbon winders is given by P equals 300 subtract 0.02 times Q. So this time we don't have to worry about what is the price demand equation. It's already given to us in the problem. The ribbon winders cost $30 each to manufacture, plus there are fixed costs of $9,000 per year. Find the quantity where the profit is at a maximum. What should the company sell each ribbon winder to maximize profit? Since in the problem that we want to find out what is the maximum profit, we need to find out what is the revenue and the cost functions for this company so that we can maximize profit by setting the marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost, R prime of X equals C prime of X. So let's start by finding the revenue function. The revenue function is price times quantity. So R is equal to P times Q. Well, P was given in the problem as 300 subtract 0.02 times Q, and now Q is the variable. 300 subtract 0.02 Q, that's the P, And then that's all times Q. You can distribute the Q through the parentheses to get 300Q, subtract 0.02Q squared. Now we need to find out what is the cost function. The cost function is using the variable cost, $30 per ribbon winder, and the fixed cost is $9,000 per year. So C of X, or just C, is equal to variable cost times Q plus fixed cost. So variable cost was 30, so 30 times Q, and the fixed cost was $9,000. So you get the cost function is C equals 30 times Q plus 9,000. So now that we know the revenue and the cost functions, we can find out the profit function. The profit function is capital P, so P of Q is equal to the revenue function at Q, subtract the cost function at Q. The revenue function was 300 times Q, subtract 0.02Q squared, so that's all in parentheses, subtract the cost function, so subtract 30Q plus 9,000 in parentheses. The negative sign is distributed to both terms in the cost function, and so after you do that, you have 300 times Q, subtract 0.02Q squared, subtract 30Q, and then subtract 9,000. Combine like terms, and the profit function would be negative 0.02Q squared plus 270Q minus 9,000. So now the point of this problem is that now that we have the profit function, we can use calculus methods to find its derivative, and then find all the critical numbers where the derivative of the profit function is zero or undefined. And then use the second derivative test for local extrema to find out is that critical number an absolute maximum or an absolute minimum value. However, let's use this new method. Let's find out the marginal revenue and the marginal cost, and then set the two derivatives equal to each other. And then once we have the equation set equal to each other, we can solve for Q. So let's take the derivative of the revenue function. R of Q was 300 times Q, subtract 0.02Q squared. So if you take the derivative of 300Q, you'll get 300. And if you take the derivative of negative 0.02Q squared, you get negative 0.04Q. So that's the marginal revenue function. Now let's take the derivative of the cost function to get marginal cost. The cost function was 30 times Q plus 9,000. So the derivative of 30Q is 30, and the derivative of 9,000 is 0. So the marginal cost function is just 30. Take these two derivatives and set them equal to each other. So marginal revenue, R prime of Q, is equal to marginal cost, C prime of Q. So you get this equation, 300 subtract 0.04Q equals 30. This is an equation that we can solve for Q. So 300 subtract 0.04Q equals 30. Let's move the 300 to the right side of the equation by subtracting it. So negative 0.04Q equals negative 270. And if you divide both sides of the equation by negative 0.04, Q is equal to 6,750. That's your only critical number. And so we know that if it's the only critical number and we're trying to maximize profit, it must be the absolute maximum. And since the profit function was negative 0.02Q squared plus 270Q plus 9,000, that's a quadratic function. Notice that the leading coefficient is a negative number. It's negative 0.02, which means that the parabola for the quadratic function's graph will open down. So that means the profit is maximized at the critical number. The profit is maximized when Q equals 6,750 ribbon winders are sold. And now to answer the other part of the problem, what is the price per ribbon winder? The price that maximizes the profit will be P is equal to 300 subtract 0.02Q. Well, if Q is 6,750, replace that in this equation to find out the price. So P would be 300 subtract 0.02Q, or 300 subtract 0.02 times 6,750, which will be $165. So the maximum profit occurs when the ribbon winders are sold at $165 each. Minimizing average cost. Another saying that you might have heard is average cost is minimized when the average cost and the marginal cost are equal. Recall that the average cost is the slope of the secant line from the origin to the point on the graph of the total cost function. So if this graph that's in pink or red is the total cost function and you calculate the slope of the secant line, the average cost is the slope of the secant line when you start at the origin and you go up to a point on the graph of the total cost function. Notice that the smallest possible slope of this secant line occurs when the secant line intersects the total cost function. In other words, the secant line is actually a tangent line. This occurs whenever the average cost is equal to the marginal cost. So you would have the slope of the secant line, or the average cost, is equal to the slope of the tangent line when you have marginal cost. Minimizing average cost. To minimize the average cost, AC of X, or you can also have this as C bar of X, find the values where the average cost function, AC of X, is equal to the marginal cost function, MC of X, or you could have C prime of X. In other words, it's where the average cost equals the marginal cost. So let's look at example 5. Minimizing the average cost. The cost in dollars to produce Q gift baskets is given by C of Q is equal to 160 plus 2 times Q plus 0.1 Q squared. find the quantity where the average cost is minimized. So the total cost function, TC of Q, is 160 plus 2Q plus 0.1Q squared, the function that's given. If we're interested in finding where's the average cost function minimized, we need the average cost function. So remember that AC of Q, or AC of X, as it was defined, was C of X divided by X. So it would be C of Q divided by Q, the cost function divided by Q. It's 160 plus 2 times Q plus 0.1Q squared, all divided by Q. So now we're going to simplify by dividing each of these terms by Q. So 160 divided by Q plus 2 times Q divided by Q, and then the last term, 0.1Q squared divided by Q. And if you simplify each term, 160 divided by Q plus 2 times Q divided by Q is just 2. 0.1Q squared divided by 2 is 0.1 times Q. So now we have a couple different ways to minimize average cost. We can either use the calculus methods to find the derivative of this average cost function and then find all the critical numbers where the average cost function is equal to 0 or where is the average cost function undefined. And then use the second derivative test for local extrema to test each of these critical numbers. Is the graph of the average cost function concave up or concave down? And that will tell us whether we have an absolute maximum or an absolute minimum at each critical number. However, as we just found out, you can minimize average cost when you find out where is the average cost function equal to the marginal cost function. So if we set these two functions equal to each other, the average cost function, C bar of Q, and the marginal cost function, C prime of Q, and we solve for Q, we'll find out the value for Q, the quantity, where the average cost function is minimized. So the average cost function, AC of Q, or C bar of Q, was 160 divided by Q, plus 2, plus 0.1 times Q. The marginal cost function, so this is using the total cost function and then take the derivative of that function. So it's the derivative of 160 plus 2 times Q plus 0.1Q squared. Use the constant multiple rule, the power rule, and the sum rule to find out the derivative of each term separately. Derivative of 160 is 0. Derivative of 2 times Q is 2. And the derivative of 0.1Q squared is 0.2Q. Set these two functions equal to each other now. So if C bar of Q is equal to C prime of Q, the average cost function is equal to the marginal cost function, you would have the equation 160 divided by Q plus 2 plus 0.1 times Q equals 2 plus 0.2Q. Notice that the two terms 2 will cancel out if you subtract 2 on both sides of the equation. So you have 160 divided by Q plus 0.1Q is equal to 0.2 times Q. So let's collect the Q terms on one side. You have 0.1Q and 0.2Q. If you subtract 0.1Q to the right side of the equation, then you have 160 divided by Q on the left side of the equation equals 0.1 times Q on the right side. And now multiply both sides of the equation by the least common denominator, which is Q. So if you multiply the left side of the equation by Q, it'll cancel out the denominator, so you'll have 160 left on the left side. And 0.1 times Q will give you 0.1Q squared. Now divide by 0.1 to isolate the Q squared on one side of the equation. So Q squared is equal to 160 divided by 0.1 will give you 1600. And now notice, if you want to get Q by itself, you need to take the square root on both sides of the equation, which will introduce the plus or minus, because there are two different solutions to the equation. You have Q is equal to plus or minus square root of 1,600, which will give you 40. So Q is equal to plus or minus 40. But however, since Q is talking about the number of gift baskets, we know that Q cannot be a negative number. So Q equals 40 is the only critical number that we have. Now let's go back to the idea of using the second derivative test for local extrema to test out at the critical number, is the average cost function minimized? So use the second derivative test. You have the average cost function, which was 160 divided by Q plus 2 plus 0.1 times Q. Take its derivative, so the derivative of AC of Q would be AC prime of Q, or it's the average cost function's derivative. The first term is 160 divided by Q, that's 160 times Q to the negative 1, so you have to use the power rule. The Q to the negative 1 will come down and make it negative 160, and then subtract 1 from the power, so you get Q to the negative 2 power. The derivative of 2 is 0, and the derivative of 0.1 times Q is 0.1. And now we want the second derivative for the average cost function. So now take the second derivative. So the derivative of the average cost function will give you C bar double prime of Q is equal to, now again, use the constant multiple rule and the power rule for this first term. So the negative 2 will come down and make it positive 320, Q to the negative 3 after you subtract 1 from the power, and the derivative of 0.1 is 0 because it's a constant. So you have 320 divided by Q to the third power. Since Q must be a positive number, the number of gift baskets, then you have 320, which is positive, divided by Q to the third power, which is also positive, so this entire fraction is positive. You have a positive number divided by a positive number. So that means the average cost function must be concave up for all values of Q. And if the average cost function is concave up, that means that you must have an absolute minimum at the critical number. So the average cost function is minimized when Q equals 40 gift baskets are produced, which was the critical number, And the average cost function is AC of 40, or C bar of 40. That's 160 divided by 40 plus 2 plus 0.1 times 40, and that will come out to be 10. $10 per gift basket will minimize the average cost. So this finishes our video on how to minimize average cost. If you have any questions about any examples in this video, please let me know. Or if you have any questions while you work on the homework for this section, please let me know that as well. And I'll see you at the next video when we talk about antiderivatives.